Hello everyone, starting with the analysis of today's newspaper, that is December 2, 2017. First is an article titled Turning the Corner. The article is on recent rise in GDP growth. GDP growth came at 6.3% for the quarter ending September, higher than 5.7% in the previous quarter, but still lower than 7.5% a year ago. The news is a cause for cheer, a ray of hope after a declining trend of four consecutive quarters of growth. According to the article, some of the positive aspects of GDP growth are: industrial growth has accelerated, manufacturing has seen a rise, and services have seen a rise. But there are certain aspects which need attention, says the article. Industrial revival is an absolute must for sustained growth in employment and output, which has happened. But it should also be accompanied by an increase in private sector investment, which is still lagging behind. Fiscal deficit is running at 96.1% of the annual target. Last year, at this stage, it was only at 79.3%. The revenue expenditure component, which is not a productive spending, is growing twice the rate as budgeted. This is another cause of concern. Compounding all this is the investment of private sector being low. It is constrained by low capacity utilization, insolvency problems, and large influx of manufactured goods. Consumption spending has started losing steam. India's GDP is driven by consumption spending and remains the key to sustaining the growth momentum. If it is slowing, means that the purchasing power both in the rural and urban areas is under pressure. The situation on job creation is also bleak. Finally, among the biggest worries is India's exports, and India stands as a sore thumb when the world at large is experiencing one of its strongest growth. The article ends saying that GST, Real Estate Act, Insolvency Code are all great reforms for medium and long term, but giving fillip to consumption, private investment, agriculture and exports is the need of the hour. Since the issue is very topical, it finds relevance only for the present, yet one dimension can be created. Placing it in the syllabus, paper 3, Indian economy. Dimension, private investment and its role in Indian economy. There is also an editorial titled Fragile Momentum on the same issue, which is almost a repeat of the article I discussed. You can just have a look at it on your own. Moving on to the next article, it is titled Scripting Another Asian Narrative. The article is about recent Japan's initiatives in the region. The article says that Japan is filling the vacuum created by US withdrawal from the region in South Asia, and the major reason for this is the Chinese muscular rise. Today, Japan believes that it can no longer rely completely on US for a defense umbrella. So there have been attempts made by PM Shinzo Abe to alter the constitution, which positions Japan as a pacifist nation. Now, just a bit of background for Japan being a pacifist nation. Post-World War II, framed Constitution of Japan under Article 9 outlaws war as a means to settle international disputes involving the state. In its text, under Article 9, the state formally renounces the sovereign right of belligerency or war and aims at an international peace based on justice and order. Article 9 also states that to accomplish these aims, armed forces with war potential will not be maintained. However, Japan maintains de facto armed forces referred to as Japan's self-defense forces. Now, these details are necessary in order to understand the article clearly. Coming back to the article says that now attempts have been made by PM to alter the constitution to recognize the legality of Japan's long extant forces, that is the self-defense forces, and also now Japan is moving towards military normalization, unlike earlier pacifist stance. But Japan also realizes that remilitarizing alone will not help. Hence, there is a need to even use its strengths, its capital, its technological know-how and its democratic credentials to beat China, and it has been doing with its following actions. Action 1. Japan pushed Trans-Pacific Partnership further with 11 nations despite US withdrawal, as it was countering China-backed Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. Now, this has already been discussed in one of my earlier videos. Action 2. Japan is stepping up its aid and investment in Southeast Asian countries. A train line near Manila, a seaport in Cambodia are examples. It also committed 1 trillion yen to Philippines over next 5 years for infrastructure development. Action 3. Japanese sales have edge over Chinese sales, which are vulnerable to safety, reliability aspects and are also doubtful in delivering benefits to local population. Action 4. Japan countering Belt and Road Initiative was sharp enough to cooperate with India, knowing that India is the only country in the region capable of countering China. Japan and India have announced an Asia-Africa growth corridor aimed at creating sea corridors linking the countries of Indo-Pacific to Africa. Action 5. In addition, Japan is cooperating with India in third country infrastructure projects such as Iran's Shahba port and possible joint development of Dawei port along the Thai-Myanmar border. Action 6. Japan has bagged the $17 billion contract to build India's first high-speed railway line linking Mumbai and Ahmedabad. Action 7. Tokyo is also investing in development projects in Northeast and Andaman Nicobar Islands. And Japan's diet has also given a go-ahead to Japan-India Civil Nuclear Energy Deal earlier this year, which is a final jewel in the crown. Japan to counter China has been actively engaged in reviving Quad. Quad as an issue has already been discussed in one of my earlier videos. Now let us place it in the syllabus. Paper 2, India and the World. Under that, subtopics. It can be placed in bilateral relations, dimensions under it. India and Japan relations in present times. Dimension 2, India and Japan relations in present times and comparison of relations historically as to how they have changed and why they have changed. Dimension 3, Indo-Japan Civil Nuclear Partnership Agreement could be an independent question. Dimension 4, Asia-Africa Growth Corridor could be an independent question in itself. Now there are some important terms in the article which need to be researched independently, like 1. Trans-Pacific Partnership, 2. Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, 3. Japanese Pacifist Constitution and its impact on regional security architecture and India in particular. Moving on to the next article, it's an editorial titled Accident Prone. The editorial says that apathy over enforcing road safety rules must stop. The most effective measure to keep roads safe is enforcement of rules with zero tolerance to violations, says the editorial. The absence of a scientific approach to accident investigation in India also remains a major factor in fixing responsibility. This was pointed out by Sundar Committee of Ministry of Road Transport in 2007. In this respect, Supreme Court's directions have played a key role. It has set up a committee on road safety and appointed an amicus curiae to help implement its recommendations. The orders of the court now provide actionable points with deadlines for implementation. But even then, the existing minor penalties are not being imposed and the road conditions remain hazardous due to poor engineering. It is time to shake the system out of its indifference, says the editorial. Placing it in the syllabus, paper 3, Indian economy, very specifically chapter is infrastructure, under that physical infrastructure, under that roadways. Dimension, road accidents as an issue in India and suggestions to prevent them. The next article, it's a news item, Cabinet gives nod to nutrition mission. The Union Cabinet on Friday approved the launch of National Nutrition Mission with a target to reduce malnutrition and low birth weight by 2% each year. The government has budgeted 9,046 crore for the mission for a period of 3 years. All states and districts will be covered in a phased manner. To begin with, worst affected 315 districts are targeted this financial year. More than 10 crore people will be benefited by the program. The core idea behind the mission is to converge all the existing programs on a single platform. The mission also aims at bringing down stunting in children from 38.4% of children in India to 25% by 2022. The mission plans to bring down anemia among children, women and adolescent girls by 3% every year. But there exists an ambiguity whether Aadhaar is compulsory to get the benefits of the mission. Care needs to be taken that no beneficiary would be denied benefits for the lack of Aadhaar card. Placing it in the syllabus, paper 2. It can be placed in schemes and programs and it also can be placed in health. Under schemes and programs, dimension, National Nutrition Mission, provisions, importance and defects if any. Under chapter health, dimension, how National Nutrition Mission promotes health and the recent National Health Policy 2017. The last news item of the day, it is titled Process to Remove Poll Commissioner's Wake. Election Commission of India consists of Chief Election Commissioner and two other election commissioners. All have a tenure of 6 years or up to the age of 65, whichever is earlier. They enjoy the same status and receive salary and perks as available to Supreme Court judges. But with respect to the removal, there is an anomaly. Under Article 324, Clause 5 of the Constitution, Chief Election Commissioner can be removed as a Supreme Court judge is done, but the same provision is silent about the procedure for removal of the other two election commissioners. It only provides that they cannot be removed from office except on the recommendation of Chief Election Commissioner. Coming to the news item, a PIL petition has been filed saying that the ambiguity about the removal procedure of election commissioners may affect the functional independence of the commission, which is necessary for free and fair elections. The Supreme Court on Friday has sought Attorney General's assistance on the plea. Now let us place it in the syllabus, Indian Polity and Governance. It can be placed in two topics. One topic is constitutional bodies, that is related to Election Commission of India, or it can also be placed in electoral reforms. Dimension under it, defects in institutional structure of Election Commission of India in general, or anomaly in removal procedure in particular, and the need for reforming it for free and fair elections. That's all for today. Please research on the dimensions. Thank you. Have a nice day.